Okay. I was asked to speak about creativity and AI and some stuff of myself. So that's what I try to do now. And I think nowadays it's quite impossible to talk about creativity without taking in concern artificial intelligence. But what I can do here for you and what I will do, it's just showing my perspective on it. You know, there are other perspectives, but my perspective on how creativity for me works and worked, where it comes from, I really don't know. You can make this second chart now, which I prove here in my post of Insta, because so many people talk about it, and actually it's the same with AI, and everybody has something to say about it, but in the end, it's like, okay, what? Nobody really can explain it. It's just a dialogue in between many people and sources and whatever. So what I will do, I don't know now the next one. I did it in the train. Can you make the next one? Yeah, and you can enter here and there will be a GIF. So yes, so what I can do is to explain how creativity, how I, because I had to do this now, thought about my creativity, because actually I never did. And I don't want to do it. I don't want to know why and where it comes from. I even doubt that I'm creative. I'm just a collection of things, somehow. How you call an object which is hollow. I'm this, and stuff comes in, and then I make an output, and that's my creativity. So that's my films I've done, showreel, whatever, all those Lindemann, Rammstein stuff, a lot of commercials. This one with the S. This is the commercial he was talking about. That was my first commercial ever. The only one I did in film school, because I kind of canceled it, let's say like this. And other videos and everything else. So all of this is, let's say, the part of the music videos is mostly my creativity. The commercials, it's shared creativity. It's a creativity coming from agency where I put my vision on it. So that's the point. Okay, then, so thinking of this, where possibly, no, you can go back, please. One back. It's actually a nice book. It's super easy, you can read it on the toilet or wherever. It's like very thin and it's really cool. And actually, this sentence says it all. It says there are no rules. So I'm doing it by my rules. This is what I want to say. Okay, so now, forwards. All right, and one more forwards. One more, okay. So I tried to make a formula for you. And I actually, it's like AI, because I put now AI and what is art and whatever. It's how I see it, yes? And how I think it works for me to understand it. And maybe it will work for you as well, in a way. So one parameter in all of this is, of course, the what the fuck, because it's always a what the fuck, but it's feelings, yeah? It's the stomach thing. yes, and I stand in profile. And this is, I think, for me, the most important parameter, I call it, you say parameter, in also understanding how to deal with artificial intelligence, actually. And when I was starting thinking about the stuff right in the moment when Till asked me to do this here, so, oh man, I have to think of this now, I don't want, it's like a pain, but okay, let's try it, I will try it for you. So I found some things which are similar to the way I think things happen, yeah? It's like a theory, right? And it's a theory that you can track back to the existence of the universe sometimes, maybe. We will come back later to it. Okay, please take a seat. Yeah, I know it's hard to find, but well, maybe, yeah, over there, yes, okay. Please let them people through, yes, okay, thank you. So, you didn't miss, not so much, don't worry. I want to excuse my bad English, I'm sorry for it. So, all right, so this is it. What I say here for my understanding that feelings or the things where feelings come from is a very important parameter for creativity. Actually, it's for me the most important. And it's a mistake from myself that I just, that usually you should have a balanced thing like feeling and let's say common sense or intelligence or I don't know, rational thinking. Those two together give the big force, but I only work with feelings. I'm very not rational and chaotic. That's what many people tell me. You can see how I make this speech now for you. Never mind, let's go. Next picture. Okay, before you start, I will show you this on this example later again. This is a music video I have done for Lindemann. It's with Peter Tedgren and Till Lindemann and Peter Stormare. And inside, in creating this video, I came back to things. It's kind of a conclusion of all this, what I'm saying today, especially in this video, I came back to an uncanny field or place where I got the ideas from. They were rooted somewhere, and I don't know why and whatever, and I will explain it to you later. So if this, I think it fits. Let's say the first minute, more or less, maybe not so loud, so I will talk parallelly. And later on, I can, maybe better, switch off the sound, please, and I will talk parallelly, explaining you what's going on, and then we go back later, and I will explain you more about the conclusions about this video. Let's try it, if it works. Let's see. Oh my God. We will get back there. Van Gogh, oh my God. And then I tried to think, all right, I think it's a similar mechanic, maybe let's call it mechanic, that okay, let's consider, I say it once, I don't want to call myself artist, but okay, let's think I'm an artist, all right? Because, never mind. So, I think that many artists have in common in their process of working, even when they don't know what they do. Things come from what they have seen in life or what happened to them. And they filter it and transport it in a way that that in the making process, they don't have a clue about it. They don't think about it. That's with me like this. I find it out later. My fuck, no, I'm repeating myself. I had this idea, but it was different. Then I really find out I'm not original. It's not from me. I didn't give a birth to it. It's something that happened and I transformed it. And so this is where complex can come, but don't be afraid. It doesn't have to be. You just have to process it. So and in this example from Van Gogh, this is why always like in a subtext, I want to bring in the way how art making with artificial intelligence might work or could work or cannot, or let's see. So I guess you all know this painting. He used to paint usually in the field. Yeah, so he painted with his brush and stuff, and the most important paintings of his life were the ones before he did his suicide. So this was the peak of his, let's say, emotional state, inside, outside, whatever. This painting was done from his mind. This is the one of the paintings where he didn't go out, and this is something he painted in his room during daytime. Because he couldn't. He was in an asylum, hospital, well, this. And he painted this. And as you see, wow, this dynamics of the stars. It's not really stars. It's something that says this is a star. And whatever it is, you know. This makes it so special. It's the first time we see stars painted in this way. But okay, so here I put you one of his conversations with his brother, that when he has a special mood, is it depressed or angriness or whatever, he's painting stars. So it's an expression of his personality, his person, which is super important later when we think of artificial intelligence, because artificial intelligence is not a person. It's a collection of messages from persons, but not a person. So, and 2 years before he painted this, or I don't know, he had even contact to that guy here, yeah? He wrote the book, and his vision of how galaxies should looked like this, right? And here, Lord Rossi. So, it's a sketch of a galaxy. In that time, impossible. You don't know how a galaxy really looks like. But if you see, there is a similar thing to this, what inspired him. And I don't want even to say inspiring, but what was rooted in his, okay, one would say mind, I say heart. What was rooted in his heart, because he was absolutely fascinated by this world and everything. This was transformed there. And I'm sure without him knowing it, you know, maybe later, when it, oh fuck, I did this painting, I hate it because this guy did it before. Maybe he discovered it where it came from, but in the moment when he did it, it's in total peace. And there's a theory of, not a theory, a thinking of a guy I'd show you later, also from David Lynch, where he explained that most artists who have like a broken soul or problems or are depressed and whatever, in the process of producing art in this moment, they are not. That's why they do it. So you have here in a let's say, I don't know, 2-3 years before his suicide, you have a Van Gogh who is totally depressed, but when he paints, he's happy, he's fulfilled. He's not depressed when he's producing art. This is something very important for you to know, that there is a healing in producing art. And, or let's say, it's the best drug ever, better than, well, You've been to a party last night, not me. Yes, it's a rush. It's kind of ecstatic. It can be, yeah. It's the feeling of happiness. And this is important also when I come back later for the artificial intelligence. Let's make the next picture. Examples. The scream. You all know it, right? And there are two reasons I put this on. One reason is that this also has a backstory. When he painted this, and he painted it in many versions, but technically because he did a storytelling thing. All his paintings combined are a big storytelling thing. So when he sold one of these, he said, oh, fuck, one picture is missing, so I paint another one. So he did many versions of this one painting, yes? And this painting is an experience that he had when he was on the bridge, and he felt in the red sky how nature is screaming at him. So this person actually is not screaming, it's the nature that screams to the person. This means this person kind of impersonates him. And fuck, I'm sorry, my telephone. Cut it. There is a backstory to it. In this stage, he was deeply depressed. His father died before, and he just came back to visit his sister, who was in an asylum. She was like in an asylum, and when he left, she was completely screaming at him. From that way, when he visited his sister, he went on that bridge and had this emotion. So this emotion was not actually just the sky, it's the backstory of what he experienced before, a total personal thing. Actually, the most difficult thing that artificial intelligence can do, give you a backstory, you know? It's like, do you remember, Blade Runner, the good one, only the first one, please. The first Blade Runner starts with the void context test, right? You see the guy asking the other person about the past. And the other person only answers logically, but not emotionally. That was the proof that it's a replicant, it's a robot. It's the same thing with artificial intelligence. You have to feed the machine with emotions, with stories and stories and stories to create something that might be possible like this, but I doubt it, to be honest. I tell you why later. So there's another interesting thing of this concerning artificial intelligence. When you see, you have actually the same motive, but you all have seen artificial intelligence like videos or pictures or whatever. You have the four versions, whatever. Look what's happening here. You see the two persons who are walking there. Then one is bending over. Then it's here again. There is a boat. They are with heads, without heads. It's exactly what when you make a prompt in wherever, Midjourney or whatever is, and want to have a picture, it gives you versions of pictures. Pam, 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 pam. And then you can animate it or whatever. But this happens when this is actually like a like an output of artificial intelligence, but handmade. So there is a pattern, which is very interesting, especially in the next person. Next picture, please. Him. I mean, when you watch it, Picasso's paintings and pictures, there are a million versions of one object, person, motif, whatever. This is actually a prompt of François Guillot. It's like if you would put it in a artificial intelligence machine, it could come out something like this, you know, if you set some patterns. But the point is, which is the next picture. The most interesting thing is the way coming from here to there. It's a quantum leap. And how comes this? How does this happen, this kind of quantum leap, or let's say that you change a form into another one? What is it? It can't be logic. It's my theory. My theory is it comes from your expressive inner side, or about questioning what actually this is. And to question oneself is totally human. It's being actually fragile. If you question your own existence, why I am here, it's something a machine never could do, because it's just there to function, to give you stuff. But to question yourself and your existence, and is the deep longing for, let's say, love, or the most archaic questions of life, why are we here? Please, next picture. You know this, maybe? It's questioning what we see. So, you know Magritte, and this is a painting of him where he says, "Ce n'est pas une pipe," where he questions the object that is painted. So, actually, this is a picture of a pipe, but it's not a pipe. So, and even if it's just a picture, is it then a pipe? Or what is it about? You know? And this is the point where, in my opinion, artificial intelligence has his limits until now. Maybe it will have later, because I tried it. I tried to talk with ChatGPT about this questioning, how about your existence. Well, I can show you later the prompt when we sit in the cafe. But it's very interesting what the machine answers. Of course, it says, "Hey, I'm here," but also it's when you put it in relation to art, and art that grows from emotion and questioning yourself, it's a thing to think of. Because one day it will be like this. This artificial intelligence thing is a tool that you all will use one day, sure. But it's about how to use and form a character, or how to use and form an emotion. But where does it come from? Where does the need to produce something, or to do something, or to think something come from? And this still remains the human thing. Okay, go. Let's make one more. All right. This is Marina Abramović. Marina Abramović, I was in Belgrade in her big exposition of all of her works. It's like a colloquium of incredible. It's an incredible work. Now, I came from, why am I here? Now I come to the most extreme form of art, where you are ready to die for it. It's, you cannot go further. Like, you sacrifice your body for it. This is what is it about. I don't know if you know it. It was in Italy in a gallery. She was standing there and had this table with all of the tools, everything, and said to the people who came to the exposition, they can do with her whatever they want. And it started to be so brutal and gruesome, because there was in German it's called Eigendynamik. Please help me, what's this name in English? Self-dynamic. There's a self-dynamic in our humans, in us. It's the part of that we don't want to look into. It's our sadistic, violent part in us, that it's rooted in there and you can't do nothing about it. It's there, you know. And it was awakened by Marina Abramović in the visitors. So it came to that point when they wanted to kill her. And then the galleries intervened and stopped it, you know. And it's like, for her, the doing art is equal to living, yeah? And to be ready to die for it, because she would die. If somebody would kill her, she would stay there and they would kill her. Because she said it's for art. It's the most, let's say, excessive, or let's know, the most, I don't want to say extreme, consequent. It's the most consequent art form, kind of, this live performance. I show you this because you cannot rationally explain this like Cécile Person-Pip. You cannot. You can only feel it. That you are now try to explain this to somebody who has no feelings. And this is where artificial intelligence gets interesting. So this means to create a person, to create art like Marina Abramović, you need to, I don't know, you need to create a person in the machine or feed it with habits or it's only text actually, but with things that kindly are illogical because they are self-destructive. And I also think this is a limit of where could we go or not. I don't want to be so negative about it because I find it really interesting what's happening there. But it's about, you can take a philosophical viewpoint on it also, you know, and don't be afraid of it, just use it. So next thing, next is things, okay. Here's how she as an artist works. This one, the Grand Prix in the Biennale, it's a work piece about the Yugoslavian war, and she was sitting there on top and rubbing bones. It was her performance for the whole, I don't know, 2 weeks, is it? Or rubbing those bones until they are clear. Parallelly, you saw the installation of some monitors where she interviewed her father and her mother. Her father, they both were partisans, and you could hear a speech about rat hunting, how you hunt rats, and it's so gruesome, so brutal. And this thing was connected with this thing because it's the backstory. And this backstory that her parents were partisans and that she was influenced by the history of her parents only could make her doing this, right? This is the thing when I try to explain you that all your creativity, if there is, and there is, everybody's creative actually, is rooted in you. It's rooted in you. Where do you come from somehow? Let's try the next. Close up. Next. Okay. Mr. Lynch. So, why did this like this? I don't know. So he actually is a, let's say a master in, can you go back to this picture, the last one? No, back. A master of this. Because if you disconnect the story and where does it come from thing, and just see this, you have this uncomfortable feeling. You don't need to explain where it comes from as an artist, and I think actually it's your duty not to explain it, because everybody will somehow have something in himself that identifies with this and that makes him uncomfortable or makes him think or reflect or whatever it is. And you just show this piece of art. And that's why I put David Lynch in there, because it's the next debut. Because David Lynch is a master of just showing it but not telling it. And we don't want to know it also, actually. Yes, we want to know it. Where does it come from? And there is a story about it. There is a, if you go to his biography, he talks about the most influential thing in him was the city where he studied, not the art institute. It was Philadelphia, and he lived in one of the most roughest places where even children got killed and stuff. And there was a constant fear living there during this time when he studied. And there are all these big industrial environments. So there is always this, we call it David Lynchian cosmos or mood, is this machine, wherever it comes from, or this sound, it's like his blood in all of his work, this industrial element. This is where you can see how Eraserhead comes from, his first film. Also, he's telling in his biography, when he was a child, he was shocked seeing the first naked woman in his life, because she was like walking senselessly on the street. There was on his street outside where he played, okay, Blue Velvet, in this family environment, all of a sudden a naked, disoriented woman walking the street. And this picture never left him. And these are the things how he approaches maybe nudity or something. But what I want to tell you is there is always something, and sometimes we don't want to know it, but it's rooted in us. And this, what is rooted in us, this is the thing that the artificial intelligence really needs from us, wants from us. Otherwise, everything will be generic. If you see what's going on now, when you see the pictures of artificial intelligence, and it's all looks same, right? It's actually almost everything looks the same, and it's super generic. And there are some people who are really afraid of it now. And who are those people? People who create generic stuff. I'm sorry to say it, but it's mostly agencies. they will get obsolete, because what do they see? Okay, I prompt a car, commercial, blah, blah, blah. What you see, voiceover, slow motion in a desert, a car, electric. And inclusive, something like this. So it all looks the same, and because clients want to be kind of generic, so this means that it all looks like some kind of advertising, but we want something else from it. And I think this is the way or the moment it will be, is because every week there's something new coming up. This is the moment when we feed artificial intelligence personality, and personality with our fears and everything. You know that there is a prompt and a negative prompt. Do you know it? That people make with negative prompts, they create stuff, which is don't do this, don't do that, and whatever. And now still it's censored, and you have some sites which do the real uncensored stuff also already. But if, I don't know, to be honest, and to everybody who I'm talking to, I don't know where it will lead us. No clue. I just know I keep on going, and you also should go. Keep on going, and listen to your thing that is inside. So let's go back. Let's go forward to this one. If you want, we can. You want to watch the whole video? Yeah. Okay. So let's play the whole video, and then I will explain you where it came from. We'll be right back. Okay. Oh, thank you. All right. I don't know if I explained to anybody this because I didn't want to, but I will do now where it comes off from, because actually it's super explainable once you know it. When you make something, you always have to decide which perspective you want to take. This means from which side you want to tell the story and who is the spectator or through whose eyes you see what's going to happen. You can change it in the story, but you have to know it somehow. And I'm definitely the guy, the drummer, who is observing a person who has two personalities. And this is the Till Lindemann and Peter Stormare. And before I made this video, I think 4 or 5 years before, I had a picture of Till and Peter Stormare, and I thought, man, this is crazy. They're like brothers. I don't believe it. This is they're like from the same mother or something like this, because they look really similar on this. And then it came out that Peter Tedgren, the drummer, is a friend of Peter Stormare, because they are Swedes and all Swedes know each other somehow. I don't know. So then, oh my God, we can use it. We can make something out of this. So the thing is, I wanted to show, and I discovered a super big mistake, and I'm totally frustrated because this now. But never mind. Maybe you didn't even recognize it. So actually, it shows a personality that is killing someone, and in from one moment, the world turns over, and then it's killing the other one. So it's reversed. It's a story told in two reversed directions, and the person is killing itself. Actually, you cannot stand another ego of yourself. You want to be your own ego. That's human, and this is like the motto that is driven to this. And I have. This is always kind of a theme of me. When I look back, or I don't know, the questioning of ego and what you really are and what do you copy, you know? Are you original? Are you artist? No, you're actually copy. You're like this person. You want to be like this person or this, you know? So this is something that's like torturing me inside. Another thing is like, maybe you realize it, it's that he's sitting on the toilet while playing drums. This is an old nightmare for me that comes back and all the time. It's like me with socks on a wet floor, sitting on the toilet in front of an audience. I really dreamed this. I think, man, why is it coming to my mind? It's like so awkward, you know? But then I decided I will film it. Why not? I have a film. Let's see what people will say and stuff. In the end, you see that the identity of Till even is not his identity. It's a picture of him. When she takes off the beard and stuff, this wasn't the real Till that we saw. And this is Cezine Pazumpip moment of that video. And I had it also in another one called Praise Abort, where he pushes back the Rammstein Till, because now it's the Till Lindemann Till in that video. I always have this thing inside with different egos and stuff. And my big hero, David Lynch in Lost Highway, he exchanged completely the person to be the same person also. So it's an interesting point. And what actually defines a person or character, or what, it's not the picture or not the appearance of what it is, it's the backstory of this person. And backstory means life, love, passion, whatever it is. But this stuff that drives you to make things. Let's go to the next chart, please. So, going back to this book, there's a very interesting sentence I want to give you, big terms for artificial intelligence. It's not an idea. Okay, so you understand? So it can express an idea, but it's not the real idea. So this means, what it means is, it's not, the idea comes from you. You need to have the idea to use the technology. Then you can create with it. But the idea will come from you. And I work with artificial intelligence as an idea giver in a complete other way. I make prompts, okay, this is, I don't know, this and this, I need this and that, and the singer is this, and the song is that. Blah, blah, blah. So what comes out is a generic, some generic ideas how everything is already there. And I use this and do everything not to make that. I will go exactly the opposite way that the artificial intelligence gives me. And this is a real cool thing, actually. That's how you go back to it's like a controlling machine where you can see, okay, my thoughts now actually are it's not the real thing that comes for me. Or let's say, it's obvious what I'm thinking now. But if you use it as a negative thing, let's say like this, in a positive way, because you do exactly something else, then you're still on the side of surprises. Okay, next one, please. Aha. I want to give you this because this is a formula I live now. It's when you have, and you should also live now. Because this stuff, which is rooted in you, and I mean, you are in an art school now, right? So you have your dreams, you want to do stuff, you want to go out, you want to create, you want to make things, and you want people to see it and stuff. And with me, it's like this. Many times, it just stays there. I don't do it. I don't know why, but it's like this. And I really sometimes have to force myself to do something, create something which is not, was heißt Auftrag? Huh? Not a job. No. Which is not commissioned, yes. Because this is super, super important for you. I will tell you later why, but you have to insist that even if you do commissionary stuff, let's say agency, sorry, but you have clients, you have to work for them, and your creativity goes to them. But in you are also a writer who wants to write a book. Do it, you know? Time is so fast. I'm getting fucking old, and it's crazy if you don't do it. And I have a mantra now. I paint almost every day a portrait of myself where I write, nicht träumen, machen. Which forces me to do it. And this is the only miracle that exists in creating something. And artificial intelligence cannot do it. We make it do it. But you have to do it. You have to be the spark who is the insinuation. Wow, words. You have to be the spark that where it comes from. Now listen to this sentence. Ich glaube, das kann man anklicken.
And so you just stay alert, do your work, don't worry about the world going by. It doesn't mean that you can sit around and not do anything. You've got to get your butt in gear and do it. And don't take no for an answer. Translate those ideas to cinema or to a painting or to whatever, and figure out a way to get it done.
Best thing ever. Keep this in mind. This is the motor of you being creative or an artist. Next, please. So, this is Leo Planck. I'm telling this here now because I need to tell you a story now. Leo Planck died last week. He was a friend. He's, I think, the best stuntman in Germany, maybe Europe, concerning cars and everything. He had a, he worked, I'm teaching also in Film Academy Baden-Württemberg, and he worked on a project of my students. And it's a really stupid accident. He fell from a crane, and the crane fell on him because he was secured on it. And there is a project from my students about, can't tell you now, super detail, but it's about freedom and freedom of thought and flying. So and war. Yeah, it's really, it's the thing that's inside you and you fear, and it's a hard project, let's say like this. The students really gathered a lot of people to work on this project for free. And Leo and all of his company, they all committed themselves to this project because they loved it so much. Yeah, and it's a 17 shooting day, and this happened on the 11th day. So they stopped the project. Yeah, and I was there and tried to comfort the students and everything. When it happened, it's really brutal. And he was the nicest person, a really nice person. And he was always barefoot. That's so crazy. He was, when I shot with him, even in winter, he was barefoot. He was walking around barefoot, and that's his signature, kind of, because he wants to be connected with the earth. So, but there's one thing which I want you to think of. There was a moment, and the thought comes to the minds of all, what's about the project? Yeah. So the person who drive this crane, all those who were involved, totally heartbroken, said, we want to continue this project. We want the project to be finished. We want it for him to be finished because he loves the project, and he also would love to be finished. He wants the film to be done because he believed in it. And the whole team, except like maybe the director, because not now, but you ask around, but the whole team, everybody who was working on this project said, we need to finish it. We need to finish it because the whole project is so important. And consider this of your work also. This is the work that you also have to do. This is the unwritten book. This is the idea that you don't do because you do other stuff because you need to survive and stuff, but you need, as an artist, to make things that keep you alive or that you would die for, like Marina Abramovic, you know? It's you need this stuff, and only this is what you could identify with. And if you do this, then you are also unbreakable. You don't care what actually people will judge or not or whatever, because the project is truth. It's the absolute truth of yourself. And this is, in this truthness, the real ideas come from. This is the real you, where the real stuff comes from. And it's unbreakable. Nothing can break it. Let's do the next, please. Yes. Dankeschön. I think I...